Well, I'm so delighted to have this conversation with you, Michelle. We've had many conversations over the years, and I'm just delighted that you are sharing with our community and our visitors today your story. And you know, as you said before, you wish you'd known this 5 years ago, or maybe longer than that. So how about this?
40 years ago.
40 years ago. You know, and I think people have been saying to us the last, well, I guess ever since we decided to do this, how timely it is, because so much has been in the news lately. There's an article in Time magazine, in the New York Times, in the New Yorker. Somebody recently came out with a children's book on transgender. So it's really very much come out of the closet, literally and figuratively, since the 1950s. And of course, you know, Christina Jorgensen was, that was, you know, the great World War II hero who went to Denmark to have the surgery. And but I think after that, we didn't hear much about it. And in sort of the 90s, and then with the internet, more people were talking to one another, and it was more people were talking to one another, and people were coming out more. So please tell us your story in your own way. And I know we've, I'll interject sometimes with questions, but I really want to hear from you.
I'm looking forward to this moment, and I've been dreading it. I'm here because I was born male, at least according. And I wasn't delusional about why they called me male. But in my childhood years, even more at puberty, that was not comfortable for me. I wanted to, I preferred activities that I was told, no, boys don't do that. I wanted a Barbie doll. Boys don't get Barbie dolls. At puberty, I said I wanted what's happening to the girls to happen to me. For 30 years, 20 years, I don't want to age myself too much. Thereafter, it was a constant battle. This isn't right. How can I possibly have these feelings? Until the burden became so much, I found it's very distracting to see women and not be thought of as one of them. And I fantasized of suicide. It wasn't ultimately the activities that I wanted. I could be a, you know, this was the 80s and 90s, I could be rebellious. It was fundamentally, how can I put this? When I was in the shower, I wanted to cry. It was fundamentally about my body. But almost 10 years ago, someone accidentally, I don't know how they did this. I had a mustache at the time. Someone accidentally called me Miss. And it was the most wonderful thing I'd ever heard. And it felt so good. And it started a deep depression that ended with my seeking professional help and an experiment. My therapist said, I don't care whether you live as a man or as a woman, but I think you do. So we said, I would experiment with calling myself a girl, a woman, just in private. I would experiment with wearing women's clothes, just in private. And calling myself a woman made me feel much better. One of the support groups I belong to hosted an actor. An actor came, was studying to be a male crossdresser character. And I told him that 5 years ago, I considered myself a male crossdresser. Because I couldn't conceive of myself as a woman. I desperately wanted to be one. But as my father had said to me when I first explored these feelings with him, that's a disease. Your feelings of wanting to be a girl are like a disease. But about 4 years ago, pressure became so great, and the experiments with calling myself a girl in private so successful that I decided that I could not be a happy person if I didn't live the rest of my life as a woman. And that's been good and bad. People tell me that I'm much happier. And I am. My mother had the best line of all. She said, I had a boy, and I had a girl, and I only had one child. And I'm very lucky that my mother supported me. A lot of trans children I read are disowned. I was afraid that would happen to me. Once I started preferring to be addressed by female pronouns, once I started dressing as a woman more often, I had to start coming out to people. And I usually did it one by one. And every single time I did it, I was afraid I was going to lose a friend. It was a relief when my mother said, you're my son, I mean my daughter. Of course I will support you. Of course, my mother didn't want to hear that I wanted to be a woman. It wasn't what she had in mind when she had a son. But what ultimately persuaded her, she told me, was that I was obviously so much happier. Actually, happy is not the right word. It's sort of like I'd been living 40 years in darkness and suddenly someone turned on the lights. It didn't make me happy. But it made it a lot easier to see the world. It made it a lot easier to be in the world. Suddenly I was much more open with people. So what do you do if you're in this position? I took it in stages. I said, okay, these experiments with wearing women's clothes are working and feeling better. When I got called Miss or Ma'am, it felt wonderful. At that stage, I didn't care if I was called Ma'am, it was still female. So I went to my doctor, and they said, I need evidence from a psychological professional that this is really right for you. We got that. And I was given permission to take estrogen pills. They feminized my body. And that was a profound relief. I was surprised by how profound a relief it was. Because of that, I was able to change my ID. My social security card now says Michelle, and it says female. The records say female. When I walked out of the DMV with my new ID card, with a cardboard version, I did a laugh on the sidewalk of the 7th Avenue that I didn't even know I could do. I was so relieved. It validated my lifelong feeling. That I was a woman at heart. It hasn't all been wonderful. I really didn't like it when the maintenance guy came to my apartment and said, "So honey, you have a leaky faucet." I don't like being called honey by strangers. But ultimately, I'm much calmer. And that has made all the stress and pain worth it.
We were talking a few weeks ago about all the stereotypes and misperceptions. And even
Spell misperception with two S's.
And you know, and there's just so much vocabulary that we had to learn. And I want to thank you sincerely because you shared your transition with me early on, and we've had so many conversations. And I want to thank you for educating me and referring me to different sources. And I love the book, The Riddle of Gender. And I learned that on Facebook, there are 50 different gender identifications. I couldn't begin to understand what they all are. But the fact that social media has certainly embraced this understanding or wants to understand and wants to provide a forum for people to not only express themselves, but to communicate with us how they feel and how, who they feel that they are. So what some of those stereotypes and misperceptions that we talked about, and it came up in some of the articles too, is it's not who you go to bed with, it's who you go to bed feeling like and who you are. Because I think that's, so sexual activity and sexual relationships are often confused and conflated, and there's a misunderstanding about that. Because again, we can have relationships with many different people, and we love many different people, but who we are ourselves and how we love ourselves is so important.
Earlier today, I was having a conversation with someone who reminded me that the early books on transsexuality and being transgender used to assume that you would be heterosexual in your new gender. I've met and have friends, transgender women who like to sleep with men. And I've met and have friends who are transgender women who like to sleep with women. It's just like any other type of woman. Some of us like men, some of us like women. It's who we want to be ourselves. I had an ignorant psychiatrist early on. I fired him for saying, "You are a man who likes women. How can you be transgender? Nothing to do with each other. Some women like women, some women like men. Some transgender women like women, some transgender women like women. Two different things."
We also talked about the LGBTQA community. Now, we talk about it as being a community, and yet often within that community, it's not so communal, it's not so community-like, because there's a lot of misunderstanding there. Even someone who was honored by the American Humanist Association, he's a gay man, he's certainly very well known, he made some statements about transsexuals and transgender that the AHA wondered whether they should not offer him that award after all, and communicated that to him, and then he clarified. He came out and but what I appreciated was his acknowledging his ignorance and that he needed to be educated. Because within that community, very often I've heard people say, gay men, lesbians say, "I just don't get it. I just don't understand it." And so even within that community, transgender, transsexual people experience some discrimination. Could you speak to that a bit?
Well, the first thing I would say is that this is very confusing. It's very counterintuitive. How can you possibly have one gender on your birth certificate, one gender in your body, and yet feel another way? How can that happen? You take it for granted. If you're born a girl, you're a girl. If you're born a boy, you're a boy. And yet for some of us, that mismatch, which I spell with two S's, happens. But it took me years to figure it out. I can understand that it's a big deal. One of my friends at the society said, "Well, you can't call yourself a transsexual. That term is offensive." And I said to another, and I was taken aback. So yes, it's another answer to say that this is confusing. This is complicated. I've talked to a lot of trans women. I've read about trans women. I've been to support groups for trans women. And never have I heard my exact story. But in every story, I hear a lot of my story. I've speculated personally that maybe some of the gay lesbian animosity to transgender people, when it exists, is that, what did Malcolm X say about Martin Luther King? "People look at me, then they look at Dr. King, and they say, 'Thank God for Martin Luther King.'" Being homosexual is more acceptable than being transgender, in general. It's been my feeling, my impression in society. So if you're fighting for gay rights, maybe, I don't know, I'm not an expert on this, But maybe you do have to make a choice between inclusion and political acceptance. What I hope, however, is that part of that animosity is based on lack of understanding of how strange it is for there to be a mismatch between genitals and your heart. That hopefully, when more people know someone who's transgender, some of this animosity to transgender people will fade. More than once, I met friends early in my transition who said, "But you look like a regular girl, a regular woman." That's the point. If they were expecting me to look like a freak, and I didn't, maybe that's where some of that bias comes from. I don't know. I know that it was one thing I feared. When I was a teenager, there was a guy in my neighborhood who was 6 foot, must have been 6 foot four. At least he looked that way to a 10-year-old. A man who would wear white gloves, a parasol, and a lacy dress. If that's what being transgender is, I don't want anything to do with it, I said to myself. But that's not what being transgender is. Most of the trans women I know dress like any other woman. If you don't notice us on the street, we're doing our job. I was powerfully struck when someone said, "Oh, so you're choosing to be transgender." No, I'm settling for being transgender. I want to have been born entirely female. I'm settling for being transgender.
The psychiatric community finally came around in 2013 and replaced the term gender identity disorder with one that is less stigmatizing called gender dysphoria. And it refers to a mismatch. And I think both the psychological and the medical community have been very supportive. And as you said, you need to go through this process. And it's going to come a long way since 1952 with Christine Jorgensen, and today, you know, we hear the actress Laverne Cox, who's on Orange is the New Black, and is also the whistleblower Chelsea Manning, and of course, Caitlyn Jenner, who's been getting a lot of attention.
I've heard of her.
Yes. So I wonder, you know, what is that? Is it helpful? I think, especially Caitlyn Jenner, I think has been a lightning rod. And people have been very judgmental. You know, she's put herself out there, as has, you know, Laverne Cox. And my understanding is that most of the feedback is really very positive. And a sense of having courage and taking that risk and of educating more people. And also there are fewer, if you say as we get to know people, that as people get to know the homosexual community, they have become more accepting. But that's a larger community. The transgender community in America has been very unclear. And a lot of that has become because it's scary. You take a big risk to come out, going through that process in private. However, the most widely cited figure today is from a 2011 study that there are about 700,000. So fewer for people to get to know. And yet, so I'm guessing that maybe it's important to have those public figures, given that the opportunity that many Americans will have to know someone are fewer. What are your thoughts?
When Bruce Jenner, who asked to be called Bruce at the time, talked to Diane Sawyer, he spoke of a type of pain that I can readily relate to. When Caitlyn Jenner came out, I was relieved that people will have a new model for what being transgender is. Someone who had that emotional pain early on and decided that they couldn't die without expressing their true selves. Caitlin said that in the Vanity Fair article. My hope is that as more people see someone they can relate to, they'll be more accepting.
Anyone like to have any questions? Yeah, Pat.
Michelle, you shared with us Friday night at Ethics and the Theater the fact that when you were a child, that your mother told you that she and your father were getting a divorce, and that very soon after he left, she welcomed a woman partner into your home. And I wondered in what way that affected you, whether that had having two adult women as your caregivers, whether in any way that affected your feeling like you were a woman.
It's a good question. Yeah, my mother was bisexual, and she was married to my father for 20 years, and about 6 months after divorcing him, a woman moved in and they had a lesbian relationship, and my mother had later upgraded to a better woman. Did it have an effect on me? My cross-gender feelings are earlier than that. And while I can't say it didn't have an effect on me, I can say that I've met transgender people who didn't have that experience. So I'm skeptical of it having an effect on me.
I wanted to ask an interesting question. If you felt like you were female right from the start, it strikes me that must have been something in your body that told you that it was part of your gene structure. And so, in fact, you always were female, even if you didn't look it. Even if you had a boy's body, you were a girl. And therefore, you're not really transgender. You just become who you are by gene. Is there any research on that you know?
I read one book on the science of transsexuality, and I've asked my therapist what the professional literature says. Both the book and my therapist said that there's a general consensus that it probably is inborn, not learned, but that they don't but even the majority that support this view don't know why or how it happens.
If I may even amplify on that, because I think you said something very interesting in the beginning. You said, even as a kid, you wanted to play with Barbie dolls, and boys would play with Barbie dolls. Now, conventional wisdom is that girls actually learn to play with Barbie dolls because they're conditioned that way by their upbringing. But personally, that was not the case for you. So I'm wondering if that actually further reinforced the idea that this is not conditioning, this is genes.
I think that trans women have something to offer on this question, but I don't think that trans women are the last word on this question. My understanding from what little reading I've done is that there's a lot of evidence that says that it's largely conditioning. You know, maybe my expression of wanting to be a woman would have been different if the lives of girls were different in the 1970s and 80s. I'd still want to be a girl, but maybe it was called, maybe my expression of how I wanted to be a girl was cultural. Sometimes I joke and call myself a tomboy. I also want to publicly thank the people in this society, and most of all, but many who have been so supportive of me. One member even gave me a piece of jewelry that she didn't want anymore. And someone also shared with me that she'd had a brief period of wanting to be a boy. And I said, I had a brief period of wanting to be a boy too.
I'm looking at the clock and I see we have two hands over here. So let's have these two questions and then we'll wrap it up. And Michelle will be available at lunchtime as well.
Hi. I would like to ask you, when I saw the cover of Vanity Fair and I saw Caitlyn Jenner's photograph, I thought to myself, oh no, here's the other, you know, Cosmopolitan magazine, Shape magazine, Allure magazine, here's another stereotypical portrayal of what a woman should be. I know for myself as a transsexual female, and I also know for a lot of my cisgender female friends, that we keep getting bombarded with this look of what we should be shooting for. How do you react to the messages that the media gives us in regard to what we should look like as women?
I would have personally been a bit more satisfied if Caitlyn Jenner hadn't chosen lingerie for the cover. That's not the image I would like people to have of transgender people. But one of the negatives of transitioning is that I do feel pressure. I do find myself asking myself, am I as pretty as the movie star? I need to put on makeup in order to look pretty. And I think that's the pressure that, I'm told that that's the pressure that a lot of women face. And oh, one more thing, disadvantage. Women, I think, will back me up on this. Men's pants have real pockets. I am currently looking at transsexual surgeons. I should note that it costs about $25,000. I'll go into massive debt, but for the peace of mind It's something I want to do sooner rather than later. It was pointed out to me that we don't see people's genitals. We don't judge who's a woman and who's a man based on genitals in daily life. A woman looked me in the eye and said, "How do you know I'm a woman?" I knew she was a woman for reasons other than, I'd never seen her naked. But I know. And it makes me want to cry. And that's why I want to change. And that's why I hope to do it. Ideally this summer.
Along those lines, I just want to quote. This is from Mara Kiesling. She's the executive director of the National Center for Transgender Equality. And she says, it's just with regard to that question about surgery, she said, the focus on what's in trans people's pants is maddening for us. It's just not what any of us thinks is an exceptionally interesting thing about us. And I want to just close with one of the things that we had talked about was that we want there to be a society in which everyone is free to explore.
Yes.
And the fact that there are children whose parents are allowing them to explore, and they may make different decisions than some trans people are making. And that may be because they were given the freedom, the acceptance, the support to explore their identity, to grow into, as Andrew said, to grow into who they are. And so I think there will be more opportunities. People will maybe be making more choices will be available to them.
I just want to say on this point, I'm actually in favor of supportive counseling for anyone who has cross-gender feelings. Or estrogen can be dangerous. It's like any other medical procedure, at least for me. I was told that my internal organs could be damaged if I took it. I was told that I would be sterile if I took it. The bodily changes are irreversible. And it could create a blood clot that could kill me. I'm glad that I didn't make that step without the counseling of a therapist who was supportive, but not, really didn't care whether I looked as a man or a woman. These feelings can be confusing. If I walked out of the therapist's office happier to be a man, my life would have been so much easier. And for some people, that is the case. They cross-dress, they decide they're happy being men, and they don't want to transition. That's fine. Their lives will be easier. I don't want to deny anyone else's experience, but I do want to say that counseling was very helpful for me in sorting out the complexities. And I also want to say, if there's anyone who's polite, who has concerns about gender, I'd be happy to talk to them. I would be happy to be supportive to anyone who is in need of support. It would have helped me.
Thank you.